I am bringing a message today called 100 One Another's. 100 One Another's. And we're going to jump right into the Word of God today, reading some verses from Ephesians chapter 4. And I'm starting with verse 1. And this is Paul writing to the Ephesian church and also writing to us through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Paul says, "Therefore I, a prisoner for serving the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling, for you have been called by God." Verse 2, "Always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other." A lot of translations say one another. "Making allowances for each other's faults because of your love. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. For there is one body and one Spirit, just as you have been called to one glorious hope for the future. There's one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, in all, and living through all. However, he has given each one of us a special gift through the generosity of Christ." Do you want to hear what the gifts are? Verse 11, "Now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church: the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers. Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. This will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. Then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed and blown about by every wind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever they sound like the truth. Verse 15, "Instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of his body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love." Let's pray. Lord God, I thank you for your word, Lord Jesus. If we didn't say one more thing today, we have spoken truth in this place, the truth of your word, Lord. I pray that your spirit would take your word and apply it to our lives, Lord. Make it be a voice in our lives today, Lord Jesus. And I pray it in your name. Amen. Well, have you ever observed someone taking a selfie? I actually meant to bring my phone up here so I could demonstrate today. I meant to have it with me, but, you know, it kind of looks a little interesting when you're watching someone and they are holding their phone out and they're trying to get exactly the right light, the right angle, the right pose, you know, the right background, and they're trying to get the perfect selfie. And you see all the expressions on their face. Oh, I got to smile a little different. Should I have my lips closed, my teeth showing? How should I smile on this selfie? How should I look on my selfie? And have had a little bit of experience with this over the weekend because I spent some time with my girls, and they love to document everything that happens with pictures. And so we actually found ourselves trying to take a group selfie, which I think they're called ussies, okay? So I think that's what they're called. But we were taking a group ussie or selfie, and we tried four different positions for the phone, four different angles from four different directions just to get the perfect lighting. I'm sure we must have looked really silly to onlookers, right? When you see someone taking a selfie, it looks a little silly until you're the one taking the selfie, and then it seems all very justifiable. Do you know that we actually live in the age of the selfie? I mean, it's official. It's official. In 2013, the word selfie was voted as word of the year by Oxford University. I mean, it became an actual word in the dictionary. In 2020, there's a new word that's being used in everyday language. It's the word velfie. Velfie. Do you know what velfie might be? It's a video selfie, okay, called a velfie. So now you learn something today at church, and you'll know how to do a velfie after today. Well, in the early 2010s, it was really kind of like what teenagers did. Teenagers took selfies, but in the present decade that we are now in, it's actually pretty much a daily habit for lots of people. You don't have to be a teenager anymore. You can take, post, and view selfies, and you can go to somebody's social media feed, and you're probably going to see an up-close selfie of them. It's just the way that we live. We live in the century of the selfie. Maybe it's partly because apparently the 20th century that we came out of was the century of self. And so we were like, we built up a foundation, and now we're not just century of self, self-absorption, self-esteem, and all those things. And of course, some of them are good things. But now we're into the century of the selfie. And so we extend our arms and we take a selfie 1 million times a day, they tell us. And there are apparently 35 million selfies on Instagram alone. So pretty crazy world that we live in. And we could talk a lot about selfies, and that's not the intention of my message today. But one thing about a selfie that struck me as I was preparing this message on a completely opposite topic is that a selfie is a picture that you don't need anyone to take. You don't need anyone to do a selfie. You only need yourself. And this is actually so far from the picture that God gives us of how we are to live our lives. And we have to recognize that in the time of the selfie, that God has a different plan for us. And he actually said way back when he created us, it's not good for man to be alone. It's not good for man to be alone. It's not good for any of us to be alone. We need each other. We need each other. And I know that you probably know that, and I'm not telling you anything new, but it's just been something that has been burning on my heart that I wanted to share this message today. And I discovered when I started looking at one another's in the Bible that there's actually one Greek word in the New Testament. We have our New Testament in English, but there's in Greek, which was it was originally written in, there's one Greek word that is scattered throughout the New Testament in the teachings of Jesus, in the teachings of his apostles, when we read those books. And this word is, I'm going to try to pronounce it, eleon, or elelon, I think it's supposed to pronounce. It's kind of struck me, elelon, kind of struck me that it sounds like all alone, all alone, but it actually means the complete opposite. And it's a Greek word that's not a verb. It's not a specific something that we're told to do. It's not a specific command, but it's a word that encompasses who we are told to do many things for, to, and with. And all alone means each other, one another, reciprocally and mutually. Now, I just want to illustrate this with a little help from my daughter, Brianna. So Brianna has a ball, and she's going to bounce the ball to me, and I'm going to attempt to catch it with one hand. That is talent. And then I'm going to bounce the ball back to Brianna. Thank you, Brianna. That's all I need. Just to give you a picture, because actually this picture gives us a way to view this word, the mutuality of one another. It is when we do something for someone and they do it back to us. That's really what this word is all about. It's reciprocal. It's mutual. And about 100 times this word is in the New Testament. Pretty incredible, actually. It's like glue in the New Testament, and it's pretty powerful. There are about one-third of the times it's talking about unity with each other. Another main theme is loving one another. Also things like humility and deference and hospitality and encouragement. We even have a one another about kissing. Greet one another with a kiss. So we're even told to do that in the Bible. And it just gives us a picture, a blueprint of what our mutual lives are supposed to look like in this crazy world of selfies and individualism. We are supposed to live a mutual life of being in relationship with other people. I love that this scripture starts out with, I beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling, Paul said to them, for you have been called. And then he starts to unpack what they have been called to. And I think it was in August, I woke up one morning and we were in this kind of a season among our staff, our pastors. We were trying to figure out the fall, like in this season, crazy to try to figure out how are we going to disciple people and how are we going to, you know, have community and all these things in the fall. And there's a lot of things going on in our mind. We're working on a lot of things. And I woke up one morning and I just felt like the Lord said to me, it's just simple. It's just two things, two words. And the two words he gave me were unity and community. Of course, community is actually has the word unity in it, but unity and community. And really, if you read through all of the one another's in Scripture, they're all about how to walk in unity and in community. I just want to talk about those things for a few minutes this morning. You know, we are a church. You heard us this morning. Pastor Joseph was here, and he was praying for another church, and he was praying for another ministry. And we made that commitment at the very beginning of our church that we didn't have a corner on the market in Williamsburg or wherever we would, you know, be able to influence and lead and pastor. We didn't have a corner on the market. We were one church, and there was all different kinds of churches in our, you know, our town, our city. And, you know, I think it's actually a beautiful picture of the body of Christ, that there are churches that are have a different style than us. They may have a different interpretation of a scripture. They have different emphasis. It's a beautiful picture because I think it shows the different personalities, and we're all part of the body, and it's a beautiful thing. And so I value that. But you know what? If I am a part of this church, obviously, and if you're a part of this church, then actually, you know, there are a lot of other great churches out there, but when you choose to be a part of a church, you are called in the body of Christ, in the local setting, to be unified and to be in community. It's actually not negotiable. And we sang this morning about Lord, send revival. Do you know that one of the ways that we open ourselves up for a moving of God's Spirit is when we are actually dwelling and walking in the power of unity? It is a powerful thing. And I just have made a commitment in my life, in the body of Christ, not just in my own church, but in the body of Christ at large, to be a person who walks in unity. I don't speak ill of another church. I don't speak ill of another Christian. I don't get out there on social media and criticize another Christian. I look at the world that we live in with the divisiveness all around us and the polarization all around us, and I have to say, you know, I can't be sucked into that way of living, that way of communicating. I want to be a person who is about unity in the body of Christ. And it's just part of who I am as a believer. And it's my heart for our church as well, that we are a church that preserves unity. Now, Ephesians chapter 4 talks about this. And I actually also want to read it to you in the message, in the voice translation just briefly. It says, make every effort to preserve the unity the Spirit has already created with peace, binding you together. And it goes on in verse 13 saying, till we all reach unity in the faith. But I love the picture that this particular translation captures is that we are not, we don't have to create this unity. We get to walk in the unity of Father, Son, Holy Spirit. They are in unity. And the scripture admonishes us to be one as they are one. And actually, Jesus himself said that his greatest prayer for the church was that we would be one. In John 17, my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message. He was praying for his disciples and also for us today who would believe on him in later years, that they, all of them, may be one. And then it goes on to say, so that the world would believe. We get to represent Jesus through our unity, through our love. People will see that Jesus was sent to love them because we know how to love each other, because we know how to love them. It's a powerful picture. The world desperately needs to see that in our lives. And secondly, community. Community is an outflow of unity. And there's so many parts of this passage that speak specifically to community. I think about community maybe as the local expression of unity, you know, doing life together. I love the phrase it says in verse 16, fit together perfectly as each part does its own special work. And you know, the package is actually not complete until we learn how to do life together. Our maturity won't be complete until we learn how to fit perfectly together, because we are the embodiment, we are the tangible, physical presence of Jesus Christ on this earth. And while we're called to grow and mature individually in our faith, that's so important for all of us to be growing as individuals, we are also called as a body to grow in our faith, to mature together. And it's so beautiful that 100 different times in the New Testament, we see the practical ways that we can do that. It's constant use of this word in the New Testament gives us the building block for our unity, for our community. And you know, these things are actually not possible for us to do outside of relationship. We can't bounce the ball and have the ball bounce back to us if we are not in relationship with people. You know, I could stand here, I don't have time, but and read a list of, I actually have a list of 35 one another's, like kind of categories of one another's powerful commands of the Word of God. But you know, all of them could be boiled down to this scripture in Matthew 7:12, which says, so in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. This sums up the law and the prophets. The one another's put this verse into action. Do you want to bounce the ball and love someone else and serve someone and encourage someone and not have them bounce the ball back or not have anyone in your life to do that? And that is why relationships in the body of Christ are so important. We are called to this mutuality together. And it makes his church, when we put into practice these one another's, when we do to someone else what we want to receive from someone else, then we are making the Church of Jesus Christ a place that is safe, a place that is where we can be healed, a place where we can find peace and we can be encouraged. Now, is the church today like this? Well, we probably have a ways to go. Are we like this in our church at Crosswalk? We probably have a ways to go. But I am so encouraged of the way that in this season that we have been in, that we have launched this fall into such amazing efforts to be in community. And each campus that we have connect groups, and they are finding creative ways to meet, whether it's in homes or whether it's outside on a deck or whether it's at a coffee shop or whether it's on Zoom. We're finding creative ways that we can be together. We've really had a lot to overcome in this season, haven't we? We've had a lot to overcome. We've had a lot of challenges. The enemy would want to isolate us, and we've heard so much about this season. You know, I was thinking about another word that I think the enemy, another thing that the enemy is using, and he can use it in our lives during this season, and that is a word, inertia. And I was meeting with some of our Connect group leaders for sisterhood, and one of the leaders said, yeah, it's so easy for inertia to kick in when we're in this season of being at home. And I thought, I know what she means, but I kind of wanted to look the word up. And so I looked up the word, and it's actually a law of physics, and it means a body at rest tends to stay at rest. A body in motion tends to stay in motion. Bodies will continue in their current state, whether at rest or in motion, unless acted upon by a greater outside force. A greater outside force. And you know, human beings can also be governed by inertia. How many remember when we first opened up our church back in June and we all had to grapple with the fact that we couldn't stay at home and do church in our pajamas? I mean, that was pretty amazing to have that Sunday morning at home. And we had to stir ourselves up and say, no, this is comfortable. This is good. And this is where I'm resting and at peace. And it's been a great season. But it's time for me to get back. It's time for me to connect. It's time for me to find creative ways to be able to connect with the body of Christ. And I think, you know, the word inertia means inactivity and passivity and apathy. And we have to sometimes stir ourselves up. We have to stir ourselves up because the goal that Jesus has for us is maturity. The goal he has for us is growing to be like him. And according to his word, what he's going to use in the process is not always comfortable. It's not always comfortable, but he's going to use us learning to walk in unity. He's going to use us learning to walk in community to bring about the goal that he has in our lives as individuals, as churches. You know, I'm a mom of a lot of kids, and it's been an adventure raising them. And you know, there's a lot of work to seeing little ones come to maturity, you know, and I'm kind of at you know, the more of this, enjoyment season right now. And last night, we got to, I got to go out to dinner with basically my adult children and spouses. And it was such a beautiful evening together. And they were just acting so mature. They weren't fighting over what table they were going to sit at. Like, you know, we did years ago. That was always the big thing, fighting over the seating, you know, and all the things that we had to deal with in seeing our children come to maturity. And I just kind of sat back and watched the scene of all of them. And, you know, I just want to just make a little aside here that I was just blown away by just having the adult children around me at that moment and their maturity, and that I can just have fellowship with them and not have to worry about all those other immature things that happen all through their growing up years. But the thought struck me, you know, it's not just about what I did and what my husband did to raise these kids, but I have to attribute some of the maturity in their lives, that they were raised in community, that they were raised in a church. They were raised in a body of believers. And they've grown to maturity. And that is the heart of the Father for us. He wants to put us in a place where we can come to maturity. Will we reach it completely here on earth? No, we won't. But we are on the path of growing and becoming mature and becoming strong in him. And he's going to use other people in that process. And so it's so important for us to learn to walk in unity in the body of Christ. We're to be as unified as a physical body. We're to be as unified as a building that's being constructed, brick upon brick or plank upon plank. We're to be as unified as a family in that moment as we were gathered around the table last night. We're to be that unified. We're to live in that kind of community. You know, the scripture talks about the opposite of the maturity and how we can live life and we can be tossed and thrown around by every new teaching. We can be unsettled. We cannot have our roots down. We can be deceived by and influenced by crazy things in life. We can be so vulnerable when we are isolated. But when we are learning to walk in unity, we are under the protection of our Father. When we are learning to walk in community, we are having our very character shaped in relationships, and we are coming into maturity. I just want to take a moment to pray for you today. If you're on the other side of the screen, if you're here in this building today, I just want to pray today for you in your life that we would, in this very challenging season that we are in, and I know some people can't come and meet in church, and it's very hard for them, and my heart goes out to people that cannot yet gather, and I understand that, but can we just pray together that we will be strengthened, that we will be mature as a church. Lord God, I thank you for your word today. I thank you, Lord God, that you want to put each one of us into your body. You want to fit us perfectly in, Lord God, so that we can live in unity, that we can live in community, Lord God. I pray that you would work in the lives of the people that call this church home, Lord God, that you show them how community and unity can be the force in their life to break the inertia, to end the isolation, Lord God, to put them in a family, Lord Jesus. I pray that you do it in the name of Jesus, that you would raise our church up as a strong tower during this time, Lord God, and everything that is happening, not only with the pandemic that we've lived through, but with the political season of our time, Lord God. We just pray that you would show us how to be light, Lord God, how to be love, how to be the body of Christ, Lord Jesus, so people will look at us and they will see Jesus in us. And at the close of today, I don't want to end today without giving you an opportunity. If you're within the sound of my voice today and you've heard me talk about the body of Christ and the family of God and the unity in the community and you feel outside, you feel alone, you know, Jesus is extending his invitation to you today. He wants to invite you to be part of his family. And you do that through Jesus Christ, through receiving the work that he did, that he died in your place. He died so that you don't have to be separated outside the family any longer. You can be brought in. You can be one with Jesus because of what he did for you. And if there's anyone in this place today, I'm just going to ask the church to just bow your heads in this moment. If there's anyone here and you've never made that commitment, or maybe you did so many years ago, but you have wandered away from the family, and you want today to say, Jesus, I want to be in relationship with you. I want to be in your family. I want to receive the gift that you give to me through salvation. I'm just going to wait a moment. If anyone here in this place today, anyone online, there's actually a button that you can click in this moment. If you want to make a decision to follow Jesus today, would you just wave your hand at me? I'm looking all around the room. I want to lead us all in a prayer today. A prayer that just, a simple prayer. We're all going to pray it together because we want anyone to pray alone. A prayer that just acknowledges our need of salvation and our desire to receive the salvation that he has for us. Would you pray with me? Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
I thank you for your salvation.
I thank you for your salvation.
I thank you that you died on the cross for me.
I thank you that you died on the cross for me.
I thank you that you rose again to give me new life.
I thank you that you rose again to give me new life.
You want me to receive this gift.
You want me to receive this gift.
Is it right now, Lord Jesus?
Is it right now, Lord Jesus?
I receive you as my Savior.
I receive you as my Savior.
I decide to follow you.
I decide to follow you.
I want to follow you for the rest of my life.
I want to follow you for the rest of my life.
Thank you for letting me be in your family.
Thank you for letting me be in your family.
And be my father.
And be my father.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.